Appeal in and for the Fifth District of the State of Florida is now in session. The Honorable James A. Edwards, Judge, presiding. All persons having business before the court draw near, give attention, and you will be heard. May God save the United States of America, the State of Florida, and this honorable court. Please be seated.
Well, good morning and welcome to a session of oral arguments here at the Fifth DCA. I've been introduced. Let me introduce my colleagues. To my right is Judge Jamie Grosshands. And to my left, we're very honored to have Eric Dubois, a circuit judge from Orange County, sitting with us. Each case has 20 minutes per side. Two of our cases, we only have one party who is entitled to give oral argument. So on the first case, let me know how much you want for rebuttal. On the other two cases, give it your best shot in your opening and only argument that you're going to have. If you have any kind of noisemakers, please turn them off or put them on silent so that your cell phone doesn't go off in the middle of your argument or even worse, somebody else's. And as far as that, we're ready to go. So we'll start with Sam A. versus State.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court.
Good morning.
Brian Savey on behalf of Andrew Samai, for the record. I'm going to start with point one.
Would you like 5 minutes for rebuttal? Is that
yes,
fine?
Yes, five minutes for rebuttal. Thank you. I'm going to start with point one. The decision made by trial counsel not to sever the possession of a firearm by a convicted felon charge was objectively unreasonable under prevailing professional standards. Every theoretical basis that was broached in the under the hearing, the 3.850 hearing, I've addressed in the initial brief and as well as the reply brief as well.
Well, counsel, tell me how you think it's impacted that there was a fairly extensive colloquy with your client, between the judge and your client, about that decision.
Yes. Well, Mr. Samai was advised, if you look at the record, Mr. Samai was advised as the purpose behind the strategy was that they believed that they would not be able to question the jurors about their preconceived notions on convicted felons unless they kept the charge together. So if they
had what page is that on in the record?
Yes, that page is page 29 of the hearing transcript, page 478 of the record on appeal.
And you know why I'm asking you about
that,
don't you?
I do.
Are you familiar with a rule that requires you to make citations to the record?
I am, Your Honor, and it will not happen again.
Okay, I'd appreciate it. Our clerks work very hard as it is.
Understood.
And it's much easier for them to do the job and us to do our job if we know exactly what you're talking about.
Understood.
Okay, thank you.
In fact, Attorney Platt, the trial counsel, testified at the hearing. The only purpose they actually discussed with Mr. Samai for not severing count two was the need to question jurors on their prejudgments related to convicted felons. Ultimately, he was affirmatively misadvised, so essentially he could not have truly understood the strategy and offered valid consent to the strategy if it was based on the flawed reasoning that was provided by his trial counsel.
If he was going to testify, wouldn't that come out? I mean, wouldn't the state be entitled to impeach him by pointing out that he had been convicted of felons before?
Absolutely. But what the record shows and what I pointed out with the circumstantial evidence is that it was not necessary, and I know that's referring to the Downs case, it was not necessary for Mr. Samai to testify to offer evidence of his intent. Again, circumstantial evidence typically is indicative of intent. So to put him on merely to contradict the witness, Mr. Brantley, it was not a sound decision at that point in time.
So you think the jury might have reached a conclusion or probably would have reached a conclusion that this was somehow self-defense when you bring a shotgun to a meeting?
I don't believe that they would have reached the conclusion that it was self-defense. I don't believe that's what the defense would have been. It would have been an explanation that he would have had it there just in case something had occurred, not that he was going to affirmatively defend himself, but that he was bringing it to because he had knowledge of Mr. Brantley's background in the military and that he had a penchant for carrying weapons upon
him.
Well,
if he wasn't bringing it to defend himself potentially, he brought it then for the reason the jury convicted him. They thought he was going to try to shoot these people.
Well, I understand the court's point, But obviously, aggravated assault and attempted first-degree murder are two different things. You know, at that point in time, he's bringing a loaded shotgun. I understand that. You know, he had ample opportunity, if you look at the evidence in the record, ample opportunity to fire the weapon, chose not to. I believe it was 25 to 45 seconds, which that was testified to by Ms. Brantley, that he had the shotgun before there was actually a discharge. And again, the discharge occurred during some sort of struggle with Mr. Brantley afterwards. So I believe that the record shows that a substantial amount of circumstantial evidence that shows a lack of intent to kill based on his actions as he approached and as he got to the scene.
But counsel, didn't Mr. Platt testify that the strategy of the defense was self-defense, and that's why he brought it? How else would you prove self-defense by not having your client testify?
I was not aware that Mr. Platt had testified that it was going to be self-defense specifically. I believe what he had testified to is that he felt that Mr. Shammai needed to explain why he brought the shotgun to the altercation or the incident.
So how would he explain why without testifying?
Well, if you look at the testimony of Ms. Brantley, I believe Mr. Platt had questioned her, had you ever discussed your brother with Mr. Shammai? I believe that the evidence could have been adduced, and obviously this was not investigated either through her testimony at the bond hearing, her testimony at her deposition, or at trial, that she had actually informed Mr. Shammai that her brother was ex-military and had a penchant for carrying weapons upon him. So that could have gotten into evidence at that point in time to show state of mind as a hearsay exception. So the second strategic basis, and again, you know, the first one I believe I've covered, you know, the relevant case law in the Florida Standard Jury Instructions would have allowed counsel to question jurors about their preconceived notions or their latent judgments or attitudes about convicted felons, even if they had severed the charges, and that's 3.8B, convictions of certain crimes and impeachment. As the decision to oppose a severance of the possession of a firearm by a convicted felon count was based on this flawed reasoning, it was objectively reasonable based on that. As it relates to the explained why the possession of the loaded shotgun, there was a failure to investigate relevant facts. And that's what I was alluding to earlier, is that there was no other witnesses questioned as to Mr. Shammai's knowledge or whether he was told about Mr. Brantley and his background or his penchant again for carrying firearms upon him. And again, Mr. Platt testified, and this is page 51 of the hearing transcript, page 500 of the record on appeal, that he did not recall having a conversation with anybody, presumably including appellant, about any connection between Zachary Brantley and why appellant had the firearm. There was no hearing testimony from trial counsel that contradicted Mr. Shammai's testimony on the record, that he had only had this discussion a few weeks prior to trial. And again, at this point in time, discovery had been concluded. No discovery depositions were, I believe Ms. Brantley's discovery deposition had already been conducted at that point in time.
But isn't that go ahead. Isn't that the trial court's job to determine the credibility of each witness? Every count in this case has to do with a firearm. I mean, who are we to second guess the trial court who had the credibility of the witnesses right in front of him testifying?
Well, the trial court didn't note that was why she was finding, the court was finding Mr. Shammai not credible. She didn't say that there was any sort of demeanor issues, any sort of credibility issues, any sort of inconsistencies. She merely said that based on the testimony of Mr. Platt versus Mr. Shammai, that any inconsistencies would be resolved in favor of Mr. Platt. However, Mr. Platt didn't testify at any point in time during the hearing that he had actually had this conversation way prior to a couple weeks before trial. There was no testimony at all contradicting Mr. Shammai's testimony. So there's no evidence in the record. And I understand what the court is saying, but I believe we would be assuming facts and evidence at that point in time. And I understand logically you would think an attorney would have this discussion with a client early on. But merely relying upon, and this is why I cited the Williams case in my initial brief, merely relying upon what you would presume or to be a good attorney and what a good attorney would do and maybe the reputation of that attorney doesn't necessarily put facts in evidence, doesn't necessarily put facts on the record. And as we had it at the trial court level, the hearing, Mr. Shammai's testimony was unrebutted on that regard.
Counsel, let's say that we agreed that it was objectively unreasonable. Where has the prejudice been established?
Sure. The prejudice has been established, and I know I laid this out pretty extensively in my brief. The prejudice is established by the fact that as the state had alleged count one, the attempted first-degree murder, they had alleged the victims conjunctively. So essentially, they would have had to prove attempted first-degree murder to each and every one of the alleged victims. As such, I believe there was very little evidence in the record, and if you obviously, I've laid that out, but very little evidence in the record to show that there was any intent to kill the child, J.Y., or Mr. Brantley himself. And the evidence shows that Mr. Sumaya approached, had the shotgun, Mr. Brantley steps in front of him. He has an opportunity, if he really wants to try to kill Mr. Brantley at that point in time, to pull the trigger. He chooses not to. Obviously, you see in the record what he says to move the kid. Now, that's at a time when he is not in, I guess, the throes of a struggle with Mr. Brantley. The one piece of evidence that I believe the record shows would have sustained a denial of a judgment of acquittal as to count one was this alleged statement, "I'm going to kill your whole blank family." And again, I would note for the record the context of which when that statement was made. And that was made during a struggle when he's on his back, according to Mr. Brantley.
But the actual prejudice, as far as the stipulation, that they were not going to sever the charges.
Right.
Where did your client in any way indicate that he would not have entered that stipulation but for his counsel's misadvice?
Well, I believe it can be implied that since he was only advised, and it's in the record, he was only advised of one purpose, strategic purpose behind doing this, that it's essentially an involuntary consent to this strategic basis, because he's advised of something that is legally incorrect, and that's the only thing he knows is to base his decision upon that. And I would argue, even if he didn't state it out loud on the record, that would demonstrate that that can't be a voluntary consent. And essentially, he's not a lawyer. He's going on the advice of his counsel saying, we cannot question these jurors unless we keep these charges together. And he says, okay, well, we need to question the jurors about this. Essentially, he agrees and acquiesces, and I understand there was a very, obviously, the court wanted to cover all the bases with that, but there was a very extensive colloquy. But again, it was based solely on this flawed reasoning, and that's what the evidence shows. There was these other perceived or theoretical basis, strategic basis for not severing, were not actually communicated to Mr. Shmai. So that would be my answer to that question. Essentially, if you look at the, and I guess I'll move on to the third strategic basis that was, I guess, theorized during the hearing, that appellant needed to inform the jury he was not intending to kill anyone, and need to refute Zachary Brantley's testimony that he had made threats to kill during the encounter. Again, intent is established through circumstantial evidence typically. The circumstantial evidence of the defendant's conduct upon confronting the victims was more than adequate basis to argue that he should have been acquitted just based without his testimony. And again, I've noted the victims were listed conjunctively. Putting a gun-wielding convicted felon on the stand merely to reinforce what the circumstantial evidence already demonstrated was an unnecessary and rash decision.
And again, though, did your client ever claim post-conviction motion in the hearing that he would not have testified?
I don't believe he actually said that he would not have testified. What the argument is before the court essentially is that his sole basis for agreeing to the strategy was based on a flawed legal principle, essentially. The tactic of putting Mr. Sumaya on the stand essentially diverted the jury's attention away from the circumstantial evidence and toward the fact that he was a convicted felon who inherently lacked credibility, should not have been carrying a gun in the first place. Essentially, Zach Brantley had testified at the previous bond hearing. Again, this sole threat against the entire family was made while this was a heated struggle. The last strategic basis essentially was that it had been, I guess, posited that Alexis Brantley needed to be disclosed to the jury as it relates to her luring the defendant into a situation extracting money. I don't believe that that was ever fully fleshed out in a cross-examination. Essentially, it was, alleged in the record that she had enticed the appellant to spend hundreds of dollars over a course of weeks. Again, this was not a legal defense, so either the strategic goal was not accomplished or it never was a true goal in the first place. As it relates to the prejudice prong, I outlined before the lack of evidence in the record to show a specific intent, a fully formed conscious purpose to kill at least two of the three of the victims. I would argue all three, but definitely Mr. Brantley and definitely J.Y. the child. I'm going to move on to the second point. The record does not conclusively rebut appellant's claim that trial counsel failed to sufficiently investigate and advise appellant as to a viable insanity defense. And again, the appellate court must accept the defendant's factual allegations to the extent they are not refuted by the record. What we have in the record is we have an opinion from a board-certified psychiatrist that is unrefuted by any other expert opinion. Essentially, we're asking the court to obviously review de novo, the standard, which is the standard on the summary denial.
Did that testimony meet the McNaughton standard?
Well, it doesn't necessarily need to meet the McNaughton standard.
That's not my question, whether it needs to. My question was, did it?
And there was not testimony. Well, but
the report, the evaluation, anything. I mean, take it in the light most favorable to your client.
Understood.
Did it get all the way
I believe
to McNaughton?
I believe it did. And I believe based on the fact in the court,
How did it? What was the statement there that would meet McNaughton?
One moment, Your Honor. He was diagnosed with a specific mental health illness, specifically previously.
What does McNaughton require? An illness?
I'm sorry?
What does McNaughton require in order to win on an insanity defense? What standard is McNaughton requiring?
One moment, Your Honor. Essentially that Mr. Sumai would not have appreciated his actions and not known the difference between right and wrong.
And did you have any report that said that?
I believe...
Any hope of a report that said that? I mean, you had mental illness or problems or whatever, but did you have anybody who actually came out and said that?
I believe Dr. Matre did, and I don't have his report with me, but I believe he did indicate to that effect in the report. And again, I don't have it in front of me to refer to it. But I believe his report would have met the McNaughton standard. Regardless, again, a failure to investigate claim, you do not need to meet the McNaughton standard. But
we have a person here who hired a private eye, drove mom's car to Florida, stayed near the airport, kept his passport in the glove box of mom's car. He rented another car so that she wouldn't recognize him, drives down, gets a GPS, come back, puts the GPS tracker on her car using gloves, so he wouldn't leave any fingerprints, on and on and on and on. I mean, this, you know, we don't hear anything about he's hearing voices, anything like that, right?
Well, what's in the record is the mental health records of Mr. Sumai leading up to this whole thing, this whole exchange at the incident when it occurred with Ms. Brantley. We have an escalation of his symptoms, and I believe if you look at the record, it indicates that Mr. Sumai had, one moment, Your Honor. He engaged in goal-directed activity, as the court had indicated, which consisted of excessive planning, which is a symptom of a manic episode, according to mental health experts. Additionally, he exhibited grandiose behavior by engaging on this long-distance trip, another symptom of a manic episode, which is what he's been diagnosed with. He also did not conceal his identity. If you look at the actual confrontation itself, he had no particular getaway plan. He engaged the victim publicly in daylight with witnesses present. He appeared to be acting in a very impulsive and rash manner. Obviously, if he was trying to get away with doing something to Ms. Brantley, engaging her with walking across the parking lot with a loaded shotgun and engaging her while witnesses are present in broad daylight in a public setting would not have been accomplishing that goal.
You've got 3 minutes left for your rebuttal. You want to save that?
Yes, please. Okay. Thank you.
May it please the court, my name is Rebecca McGuigan, and I'm here on behalf of the state. After the hearing, the trial court found the decision regarding severance to be strategic, not unreasonable, and that the defendant had failed to show prejudice. This decision was made after the trial counsel considered all of the evidence in the case, discussed it with his client. It was discussed on the record, including the fact that there was a risk that if he didn't testify, that the jury would have never learned his status. I really encourage you to read Mr. Russell's voir dire of the jury and try to envision how that would have occurred without revealing the defendant's status. Unless you have any questions, then we'll rely on our brief and ask that you affirm.
Questions?
Thank you.
Based on the arguments made by counsel as it relates to Mr. Russell's voir dire and how he could have approached this issue, without disclosing that it was Mr. Shammai who was the convicted felon very easily. He could have asked their opinions in general on convicted felons without revealing that it was Mr. Shammai himself. Could have said something, we may have witnesses testify in general who may have certain impeachment or certain impeachable offenses, specifically crimes of dishonesty or felony convictions, and he could have asked in a very general term without disclosing Mr. Shammai's status as a convicted felon. So I obviously my remarks are confined to the argument just made by counsel. I believe that's what she asked the court to look at, and I would argue that he could have done it very easily without disclosing Mr. Shammai's status.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.